A very good morning to all of you. I welcome you all to the first lecture of Quantitative Decision Making. Myself, I am Dr. Gayatri Bund, and I have done my BSc in Computer Science, MBA and PhD, and now would be the course teacher for Quantitative Decision Making. Now, as the name suggests, the course deals with decision making on the basis of numbers, on the basis of quantitative data alone. Statistics is considered as a prerequisite for the decision making in any field of management, be it finance or marketing or human resource or operations. All the management positions involve the decision making, and hence interpreting the data is a primary requirement. The data is present everywhere. Statistical techniques are required to make many decisions that affect our life at organization. Statistics is the science of collecting, organizing, presenting, analyzing, and interpreting the data to assist us in making more effective managerial decisions. The statistical analysis is also used for summarizing the data, investigating the data so that we get some useful information for making our respective decisions. In other words, let me just tell you, statistics is a bunch of numbers fighting with each other and trying to give us some logical suggestions about the available data. They help us to make the data more meaningful and comprehensive, and to present the data through tabular and graphical representations, which help us in summarizing the big and the multiple data into meaningful groups and categories for better understanding of the data. The steps that we usually follow for describing our data is better included by the collection of data first, which is generally done through the survey of a population or a sample, which is then followed by categorizing the data and presenting it by way of tables and graphs, and finally using a statistical tool like measures of central tendency, correlation, regression, trend analysis to summarize and interpret information collected through the various sources. Let us start with the primary requirement for categorizing of data and systematic, classified and tabulated data. Before we start, we need to understand some basic terminologies which is used in the tabulation and classification of data. The first of it is data. What is data? Data are the facts and the figures that are collected, summarized, analyzed, and interpreted. Let me give you an example. For example, the stock price of IBM is $80. The sales revenue of IBM is $100 billion. These are individual datum which are called as together called as data. The data collected in a particular study are referred to as the data set. That is basically, if we are considering the stock price and sales revenue of various firms like IBM, Dell and Apple, then these set of values of all the companies put together is called as a data set. For example, in the given table, we can find that the several stock exchanges considered the respective annual sales and the shareholdings, which are called as data. The various companies which are considered are called stock exchanges. These are called as the data set. The elements. Elements are the entities on which the data are collected. The various companies in the previous example are called as elements. A variable. As the name suggests, a characteristic of interest which varies for the different elements, like the sales revenue and the stock prices. These are called as variables. The set of measurements collected for a particular element is called as an observation. That means the sales revenue and the stock prices collected for a particular year together are called as observations. So let us look into the same example again. For this OTC extension, OTC stock exchange, the annual sales in millions is 74 and the shareholding earnings is 1.67. So this entire one row is called as an observation. The various elements considered, stock exchange is an element, annual sales is an element, shareholdings is an element. So these are the variables which have been considered in our data, and the different companies which have been considered are called as elements. Let us try to read this and try to find out a particular inference which we can draw from this given data. Let us read. In 1990, out of a total of 2000 students in a college, 1400 were from graduation and rest from post graduation. Out of the 1400 graduate students, 100 were girls. However, in all, there were 600 girls in the college. In 1995, the number of graduate students increased to 1700, out of which 250 were girls, but the number of PG students fall to 500, out of which only 50 were boys. In 2000, out of a total of 800 girls, 650 were for graduation, whereas the total number of graduates were 2200. The number of boys and girls in PG are equal. Now the numbers present in this paragraph makes it very, very difficult for interpretation. It in fact increases the complexity as I read through this paragraph. Hence, it is important to summarize the given data for a better understanding and a meaningful conclusion. So let us begin with the categories for classification. Now if you read the sum, we have identified the three important categories. The first category is the year, where there are 3 years data given, which is 1990, 1995 and 2000. The second category which we have identified is the gender. The first is the boys, the second is the girls. The third category which we have identified is the course, graduation and post-graduation. Now these are the three important categories which we have identified through the entire big paragraph which has been given to us. After the identification, it is important to tabulate the data. Now what do we understand by tabulation? The tabulation gives the data an orderly arrangement in order to highlight its basic characteristics. In the simplest way, if I have to define, it is basically a logical, systematic arrangement of data in rows and columns, which is designed to simplify our presentation for purpose of statistical analysis. The basic objective of data tabulation, one is to carry out the investigations of the data collected. Second, it helps us to make meaningful comparisons, like if we want to compare between the different year, the number of graduates, postgraduate, change in percentage, increase in the gender like boys and girls. The third category would be to locate for errors in the data, any missing data which is not yet collected by us or is required for further analysis. It helps us to study the trends analysis to identify the various increase and decrease which is happening with the data. It helps us to simplify the data of a paragraph into few numbers for logical conclusions. Now this is a basic format of a blank table which we have. We always have the caption where we put in the heading of the data we are going to enter. The various categories are divided into different headings and subheadings. each of the subheadings has the various categories included, and we also have the row total and we have the column total. Let us try to put the given data into the meaningful conclusions. Now, the data which I had read out to you. Let me put the heading as the course and the gender distribution of students for 1990, 95 and 2000. This entire course, which is the basically a caption which can be varied and as named by the students as it is comfortable. The three data which we had, or the categories which we had, one was year, the other was gender, and the third was course. Maximally, we always try to use the year data into a columnar form. The other two can be interchangeably used in the row and in the column. Now, with the given data, like in 1990, total of 2000 students. So, in 1990, we find that there are a total of 2000 students, out of which 1400 are pursuing the graduation and the rest are going for post-graduation. Out of this 1400, the 100 are girls. So this is the given data about 1990, and in all there are 600 girls in the college. So this is the total column, this is the individual column, and this is the graduation and post-graduation total. Similarly, for the year 1995. In the year 1995, the number of graduates increased to 1700. So, total graduate students are 1700, out of which 250 are girls. Number of PG students fall to 500, out of which only 50 are boys. This is the required data given in 1995. The next, coming down to the year 2000. In 2000, out of 800 girls, 650 are for graduation, and the total number of graduates is 2200, and the number of girls and boys are same for PG classes. Once we have filled in the required data, the next step goes is identification of the missing values. Like we know that in 1990, the total number of graduate students are 1400, girls are 100, so the remaining are boys, which is 1400 minus 100. Total number of students are 2000. Graduation, it is 1400. For post graduation, it would be 2000 minus 1400. Similarly, there are total of 600 girls. So 100 girls are doing the graduation. So the rest, that is 600 minus 100, would be doing post graduation. So, by these calculations, we try to fill up all the missing data which is not there in the paragraph, and we try to complete this entire tabular data, which makes us easier for better interpretation and analysis of data. Now, this is a meaningful data we have converted or we have tabulated from a given paragraph. Now, this helps us to have a perfect understanding of what is happening, understanding the trend, simplifying of the data. Now, if we look at the post-graduation girls, in 1990, the girls are 500. In 1995, it is 450. In 2000, it is 150. So, we can see a decline in the trend of the number of girls doing a post-graduation course. In a similar way, let us look at the girls doing the graduation. In 1990, it is 100. In 95, it is 250. In 2000, it is 650. So we can see a gradual increase in the number of girls who are doing their graduation. So such data, if represented in a tabular form, help us to make a lot of logical conclusions, decisions, and summarizing of data. Percentage change in the boys for doing graduation or post-graduation. Percentage change in the total number of students doing graduation or post-graduation with respect to the year like 1990, 95 or 2000. Such conclusions make it very, very easy for us to analyze when we have the entire paragraph data presented in the form of a table. Thus, tabulation of a data is very, very important in order for the simplification and systematic orderly arrangement of the data to make certain logical conclusions. Let us move on to the next important fundamentals of statistics, classification of data. Classification is basically a process of arranging the data into sequences and groups according to their common characteristics or separating them into different but related parts. The basic rules of classification: the classes should be unambiguously defined. That is, they should not be open to more than one interpretation. A uniform, universal acceptance and meaningful discussions which stands for one and for all. The classes should be exhaustive. That is, with respect to the given data, all possible values should be considered and no values should be omitted or dropped. As far as possible, the classes should be of equal width. There are different types of classification, like a simple classification, which is at one level, or there, if there are multiple levels, then we treat them to be as manifold classification. Let us read this data. The table below presents the total number of overtime hours worked for 30 consecutive weeks by the machinist in a machine shop. The data displayed is here in a raw form. The numerical observations are not arranged in any particular order or sequence. So it is very, very difficult to make any kind of analysis through these 30 observations which have been given. The first step, let us try to have an ordered arrangement of the array which has been given. So looking at this, it provides a quick look at the highest and the lowest value, where we find the lowest overtime hours is 84 and the largest overtime hours is 95. It helps us to divide the data into various sections or parts, and it helps us for more logical conclusions. Like 84, there are two values, 85, there are two values, 88, there are four values, 89, there are three values. And in this way, we can find the total number of overtime hours. These are the respective ones called as tally mark. That is, for every individual value in the table gets a tally mark of 1. And once we have four important tally marks, the fifth is a cross. The sixth is again a vertical line, and the same process goes out at cutting out for every five intervals. So this is called as a frequency distribution. A frequency distribution divides the observations in a data set into conveniently established numerically ordered classes. Now, how to construct a frequency distribution? It can be one single values, or we can, if the number of the lowest and the highest is large, then we can group them into different classes. Now, how do we group them into different classes? As a general rule, we find that the frequency distribution should be at least 5 class intervals, but it should not be more than 15 classes. Now let us say, if K represents the number of classes and N represents the total number of observations, then the number of classes which can be formed is equal to K is equal to 2 raised to the power of K is equals to N. Now over here, if we have 30 values, so 2 raised to the power of k is equal to 30. Now k is will be equal to 2 into 2, 4, 4 into 2, 8, 8 into 2, 16, 16 into 2, 32. That means we need to go up till the total number of observations, or more, one more than the total number of observations. Hence, with the 30 number of observations which are given, we can divide them into 5 classes. So 2 raised to the power of k is equal to 30, where k will be equal to total number of class intervals, which is 5. The another method of finding out the number of classes, as given by the Sturge rule, which is where k is equal to 1 plus 3.2. 2 log n, where n is number of observations. So we get that the total number of class intervals, or the classes which can be formed, is 5.75, which is approximately either rounded off to 5 or to 6. Now, how to determine the width of the class intervals? The width of the class interval is equal to the largest numerical value minus the smallest numerical value divided by the number of classes desired. Now, as we have seen with the logical array, the smallest value is 84, the largest value is 95, and the number of classes desired is 5. So, the calculation would be a 95 minus 84 divided by 5, which is equal to 11 by 5, which is equal to 2.2. So, approximately the width of the class interval can be taken to be 3. Now, to determine the class limits for each class intervals, a class basically has two limits called as the upper limit and the lower limit. Now, if suppose we have 84 as the lowest and each having a width of 3. So, in that case, the first class interval would be between 84, 85, 86. So, 84 to 86, which includes the values 84, 85 and 86. But here again, we have two different ways of classification. One which is called as an exclusive method, the other which is called as an inclusive method. Exclusive method is like 30 to 40 and 40 to 50. Over here, the 40 is excluded in the first class interval and is included in the second class interval of 40 to 50. That means any data set having a value of 40 will not be included in 30 to 40 but would be included in 40 to 50. This is called as an exclusive series. So, in this exclusive series, the numbers considered in 30 to 40 would ideally be from 30 to 39. The next class interval would be from 40 to 49. So, this is called as an exclusive series where 40 is excluded in the previous class interval and is included in the next class interval. The alternative is an inclusive series. Inclusive series includes both the limits of a class interval, that is the lower limit and the upper limit. Like in 0 to 10, where 0 is also included in the same class interval and the 10 is also included in the same class interval. Similarly, 11 to 20. So, 11 and 20 both are included in the same class interval. So, we can do the classification of classes as according to an exclusive series or to an inclusive series. And if done in inclusive series, it can also be converted into an exclusive series by what is called as a correction factor. So, the correction factor is the lower limit of the second class interval minus the upper limit of the previous class interval divided by 2. By this correction factor, we can convert an inclusive series into the exclusive series. I suppose I have been able to deliver and give you certain basics of requirements for tabulation and classification of data, which is forms the crux of a statistics. And once we have this particular data in a tabular form, in a classified form, it makes us much more easier to analyze the data, summarize the data, investigate the particular data. And I thank you all for a patient listening, and thank you very much for listening to this entire presentation. For any queries, you can contact the faculty course teacher, Dr. Gayathri Bhand. Thank you, everyone.